We will try our best to make this session interesting. Let me introduce myself first. I am your moderator today. My name is Bruno Jarry. I'm French, and I have had a long career in the industry, in the bioeconomy, actually, because I used to manage Orsan, which was a subsidiary of the Lafarge Group, making amino acids by fermentation. Then I moved to Belgium in the Amylum Group, and then in U.K. with Tate & Lyle. Since I have retired, and I was nominated a few years ago as a senior advisor to the Prime Minister's office in Paris, in charge of bioeconomy. And at the time, bioeconomy was mostly biofuels. So I had the responsibility to give advices on how to indeed run the policies for biofuels and introduce policies for biofuels from the French side. So I stop on this. Today, we will talk about a difficult subject, which is how to mobilize EU funding instruments for the bioeconomy. We have heard in the previous sessions that indeed the EU Commission in general, and in particular the DG Research, has put a lot of instruments in the past, is now putting new instruments to help funding the innovation in that field of bioeconomy. We have heard about this big project, public-private project funded with €3.75 billion for 5 years, about. So indeed, there are instruments available, but we know also that those instruments are usually known by a happy few, I would say, a rather small number of interested parties, including governments, actually, who are not always aware of where the money is, what are the rules to access it, etc., etc. So the availability of the instrument is one thing. How to use it and how to make use of those instruments is another thing. And I thank the organizer for choosing this topic for this session, because indeed this is a very important and interesting subject. We will have two speakers. On my right, Mrs. Baudelaire, who is in Brussels in charge of the Romania region, Emilia-Romagna region. And she is looking indeed on how to use those instruments built in Brussels for the usage of this Emilia-Romagna region here in Italy. And she will give you her views and the pros and cons and how all this can be managed. And on my left, I have Lustra, who is French from Dijon, and she is part of Pôle de Compétitivité, which is a special kind of organization. In English, we call it clusters. And she's bringing together small, medium, and eventually large companies who are seeking money from governments, from the EU, from the region, etc., etc. And she will give us also practical experience on this hard work. So, Lorenza, the floor is yours.
So good afternoon, distinguished guests, Mr. Chairman. Many thank you. It's a big pleasure and an honor to be here today. When Professor Favre invited me, the guide on synergies from the European Commission, synergies between European funds, had just been published after 4 years of inter-service negotiations. And this is the product of 4 years negotiations between the different DGs of the European Commission. And this came out from a DG... DG Regio, so the ministries that in Brussels deals with the cohesion policy and deals with the regions, but in a contact with other DGs from the European Commission. Now, I don't know how many of you are familiar with structural funds or with Horizon 2020 and research and development. Can you raise your hand how familiar you are with structural funds? So much more on research programs. Well, the big effort then is to make a long story short and easier and to try and sum up, given the time, to sum up what these synergies are and why the European Commission came up just now with these instructions for regions, for private stakeholders, even for member states, in order to make the impact of projects much bigger, basically to in order to increase research and development projects. So the idea is to summarize my intervention in 4 points, no more, because it's, as I was saying, just 5 o'clock in the afternoon, and I think we our brains are full of bioeconomy and biotechnology things. So first point is why the synergies, what for, and how to implement them. Second, do we need synergies for bioeconomy? Yes, no, why, how? Third, why are regions so important? Why regions come on board talking about synergies and talking about bringing together different European funds? And then, because I have the honor and pleasure to represent a bigger European region in Brussels, Emilia-Romagna, I think it is it would be probably worth to give a couple of elements about our experience in Emilia-Romagna. We have some colleagues from the region that reflect, indeed, what the European Union has been working on in the last few years. So, how shall we define synergies? Synergies is not just adding funds, it's using funds in a complementary way, responding to the need of bringing together different policies from the European Union. As we heard during the day, even the new president of the European Commission, Mr. Juncker, stated at the European Parliament in the first part of his speech that we need integration of policies, first. Second, that we need more investments, from which a new package of 3 billion for investments in innovation to enhance competitiveness. So synergies are needed, and this is the leitmotif of this guide, to make the impact of each single strategic project bigger. Basically, they are needed to increase investments in research and innovation. And at the end of this story, also, they are needed to help spend more, spend better. Because we know that across Europe, there are also areas across the continent where funds are not spent as they should be. The basic principles that is written here, this is 40 pages, but in 4 lines we can probably sum it up, is that for each project, in each project we can use funds complementary. And this means that there should be no substitutions of funds. not between national, European, or regional level, and not even between regional and private. So basically, no double funding. Instead, a joint strategic coordination of actions. Okay, 3 points. Very simple. And when you will think of, about strategic projects, do think in a synergic way, especially think of in a strategic way. Now, Professor Fava asked me to describe synergies between structural funds that today are called, in the new programming period, European Structural and Investment Funds and Horizon 2020. But to be correct, this this guide also relates to all EU programs, all EU co-funding programs that deals with innovation and competitive actions. So COSME, Erasmus, many other programs you might be familiar with. Because of the probably lack of time today, we will focus on these two areas that are indeed the most relevant. The big challenge is the following: how to bring together two different worlds. Most of you, and I see you have people from New Zealand, but most of you might be more familiar with research and innovation programs than with structural funds. But here you can see two major differences that really make the two worlds very diverse. Structural funds, first of all, are those funds devoted to cohesion and capacity, for instance, how to build research and innovation infrastructures. So cohesion and capacity is the leitmotiv. They are based on 7-year programs. They are usually managed by regional authorities, so they are based on the share management. They are place-based. They do not need, so far, transnational partnership. They are based from this new programming period on a priority setting, which is called smart specializations, which we will discuss very shortly. And overall, they are pretty complex. And this is probably the only common element with the Horizon. Horizon 2020 today, so is what comes after these numbers of research programs, usually still managed by the European Commission, so not directly by regions, but from Brussels, is a non-territorial program, okay? You need transnational partnerships. It is a program that doesn't address to capacity but to excellence. So we are really talking about excellent projects that address the European industry research. They are based on a 3-year work program. So the time is much shorter than the 7-year programming that is devoted to structural funds. And yes, it's based on a competitive course of proposals. So if you want, it's much more competitive. Look at the different budgets also. For European structural funds, we have 351 billion. For Horizon, we have around 80 billion. Everything in a time schedule of 7 years, so from 2014 to 2020. The message is how to bring together these two very different worlds. And here it is. The complexity is not just given by the different philosophy here, but the complexity is also given by the plethora of tools and of instruments. I don't know how familiar you are, but even experts in this room would have problems to remember right now in 5 minutes every single instrument, every single tools, every single mechanisms and procedures. This is probably the downside of this stairway to excellence. Now, the good news is that in this new programming period, the European Commission has also thought about bridges between each fund. Horizon 2020 now has the possibility to bridge projects to structural funds, and the other way around. European structural funds has now the possibility to develop transnational projects and link it to Horizon 2020. For instance, in our regions, even in a structural funds that is traditionally very regional, like the rural development funds, five percent will be devoted to Horizon 2020 projects. So bridges have been foreseen. So synergies are needed, are probably a great expectation from the European Commission, is something ambitious. But let's be provocative and let's be honest, as we have to use then European funds. This guide has just been published and probably is a little bit too late, because the operational programs related to structural funds are basically almost done by every single region in Europe, especially the most advanced one. So probably there's too much in this guide, and it has been published too late. So probably, to be honest, these synergies will be implemented, but probably not entirely in this programming period. We will have to wait for after 2020. Second message is that these synergies should not be an aim, but rather a mean to achieve something better. Third, synergies should not be a one-size-fit for all approaches. We should think of those diversities that were advocated earlier on, even by the commissioner. Each region is different. Each private company is different. So let's use synergies in a flexible way. And then synergies can only be achieved today in this historical context with the regions. And now we will see in the next few minutes why. I still have a few minutes. I would skip synergies. Why is bioeconomy so important? Because I think all of us have understood it today. But synergies can and should be applied in the bioeconomy perspective through a regional dimension. Why? Because bioeconomy is a priority all over Europe, and because bioeconomy is place-based, so it is easy to implement and put forward strategic projects in bioeconomy at regional and local level. So bioeconomy can be implemented, can be realized by regional tools. Namely, one is a smart specialization, and second is by Horizon 2020 projects developed also at regional level, but across Europe. Smart specialization is a process of a priority setting, which is a conditionality to receive structural funds. There is an observatory in Sevilla, coordinating by the Joint Research Center. And before coming here, I took a look at the different smart specializations of European regions. Around 40 also mentioned bioeconomy priorities or biotechnology priority, or more generally, green economy priority in their own smart specializations. In Horizon 2020, we have possibilities, and we heard it today, in the area of societal challenges within industrial leaderships, namely the CATS, and with the joint technology initiatives. Let's focus just a second on this smart specialization strategy. You will come across it. Again, it's a process of priority setting in regions and member states for innovation strategies. And why is it important when we think about synergies? Because smart specialization strategies are being implemented in the different regions through a participatory approach. Also in our region, in Emilia-Romagna, we have here some colleagues that were the major characters of this smart specialization, bringing together the different actors, making the quadruple helix a reality, working with companies, the private sector, working with universities, working with a research center. Through this integration, through smart specializations, also the bioeconomy let's say, sector will become a reality and will help developing new competencies, will increase the resilience, will do whatever we heard today to fostering European technology. If you want to work with European regions, if you want to develop European strategies, you can refer to a number of networks that are based in Brussels and work with regions in the field of research and innovation. The most active, the most relevant today is called ERIN, and the philosophy behind it is, and I quote the president, that strong regional partnership in regions and between European regions, building on innovation and ecosystem capacity, including with the bioeconomy, will be the key to future success. So the key for future success is to develop synergies by working with the regions. We have no other way around out, because structural funds are a regional tool. This is just an operational working group of an ERIN on bioeconomy. And what I'd like to share with you in a couple of minutes before concluding is that a region like Emilia-Romagna, we're talking about 4 million people, so as big as some member states, with a high concentration of small and medium enterprises, more or less 400,000, a number of important sectors, those that you can see over there, mechanics, agro-food, maybe here we can see them better, some of the value changes that also contribute to develop bioeconomy. These value changes have been developed in the last few years, already using structural funds and research and development programs. If you see this map, you see here a network which is called High Technology Network, and we have here the representative of Astern, which is the organization in charge of them. Those have been already put in place by using effectively structure funds and using research program. Those are let's say technopoles that have been developed have already been developed in a logic of a synergy, following the major clusters that you can see here, developing training, education, and university networks along our major value changes. So an approach of integration, an approach of synergy was already there. Now the big challenge is to implement it in an even stronger way. The complexity I was mentioning before, of course, each region has to face it. This is the complexity and how to approach synergies in Emilia-Romagna. You see, you have to deal with the national and European governance, you have to deal with programming timing, you have to develop operational programs. So it's not just as easy as it could be just by, you know, writing down a guide. You have at the end to bring actors on board and to win projects. This, for instance, is our smart specialization strategies. Once again, developed in a logic of synergy, a smart specialization strategy that reflects on our clusters. We see here the traditional clusters, but also the those with a higher potential of innovation. You might wonder, what about bioeconomy? Well, the choice was made not to mention it explicitly, but to use it as a cross-cutting sector, as a systemic approach, if you want, and maybe I'm going too far away, to use it as a mainstream, now it's very fashionable, this word in Brussels, like a regenerative approach, always in the logic of policy integration and synergies between funds. So let me try to conclude. This, for those of you that would like to know more about our projects, we have projects, again, developed also through European funds in the area of biorefineries. Today I met the colleague that is dealing with the climate kick that also involves regions. We have here the representative of the World Food Research and Innovation Forum. That is another strategic contribution to Expo. A number of projects have been developed that tackle or that developed bioeconomy tools. So Emilia-Romagna, and I really conclude, reflects today the developments that are under taking that are undergoing in Brussels in a synergic way. So let's conclude. Yes, synergies are needed. This is a good effort, very ambitious. Yes, we need synergies also in such a fascinating sector as bioeconomy, but we have to pay attention not just at the regional or the European governance, but also at the vertical governance, what our capital do. We have to make sure that all stakeholders are on board. So quadruple helix is necessary. We have to develop a new mindset, so new skills, new competences, in order to produce that legitimacy, especially of consumers, that was advocated many times today. We need to make sure that there is an assessment. We have to make sure that we know who does what. Many times in our European regions, we didn't know who was in charge of which project. We need to respect diversity, especially in a sector like bioeconomy, which is so local, territorial base, but also we need to consider international cooperation as strategic. Instead, all of us, let's put it this way, is provincial. We think that, you know, our region, our city is the center of the world. Without international cooperation, there will be no success with Horizon. At the end, we need regions. No regions, no innovation. No regions, no synergy. And this is the message I like to leave you with. Basically, no region, no regions, no part, if you want to. and this the just the ordinary, just details if you need to.
Thank you, Mrs. Badiello. Very interesting. And indeed, very complex. Could you tell us what is the time course to sort out all this complexity? How long before funding a given project you have to start in Brussels or in the territory in order to achieve something a few years ago? What
few years means? It depends on the project. Are we talking about structural funds? Co-funded projects, or are we talking about research projects?
Structural funds.
Such a funds, you can have a regional. I mean, every year you can have a project co-funded, but every single region organize it as it wishes. So
there is a lobbying stage.
Not for structural funds.
Territorial level beforehand.
The lobbying for structural funds should be done at territorial level, but. More than lobbying, it should be a coordination with the regional governments and the different stakeholders, since that is different from Horizon.
Question from the floor. Comments? Everything clear? It's a complex subject. I'm sure you can come back later and ask for more data. This is Lustra.
Okay. Hey. Good afternoon, everybody. So it not be so easy to end up this session, but I will try to raise your interest. I would like first to thank the organization committee. To invite me to present some practical case about how to mobilize European fund. So it will be quite practical. I will just introduce you what is Vitagora Cluster and what we do in terms of action. And then I will go through four practical cases of mobilizing funding for the bioeconomy. So what is Vitagora? Vitagora is a French food cluster. It's an innovative cluster, and our mission is to foster the growth of our member company by helping them to innovate either on their current market or on new markets that could have opportunity in high value chain. And we are based mainly in three regions, in Île-de-France, Burgundy, and Franche-Comté, so north and east of France. We have a specific strategy. Each cluster, we are 71 clusters in France, and 10 are about bioeconomy. And our strategy is to ensure wellness for consumers by using sustainable food system. What we mean by wellness is wellness of the food that you eat, so pleasure of the food that you eat. It's wellness because your food give you or maintain you in a good health. And it's wellness because your food you have chosen answer to your ethic value or to your environment values that make you life. For consumers with S at consumer, because we think that there is not one consumer, but we need to understand deeply the consumer behavior, the preference of each group of consumers, so that we address young children, how their preferences are raised, but also aging people or sportsmen, they don't have the same needs, and we need to think about what we have to offer them. And when we say sustainable food system, it's something that we have defined as to offer food that is healthy and balanced, and that meets the consumer need for nutrition, taste, and also preserving the environment. So that is our strategy, and it is based on three pillars. And the pillar was designed by the strengths in terms of research, academic research teams that we had on our territories. They are quite excellent in pleasure, in eating, and in taste, in health, and in environment. We have big teams, research team on this thematic on our territories. And we address three main markets: manufactured food product, functional food and supplement, and cooking appliance. For sure, we are looking on other markets that could be new opportunities for our companies, like Cosmeto food, for example, that's quite innovative in our European countries. And we look at all the services around these three main markets. And our goal, our first mission within the team of Vitagora is to link industry, research, and higher education so that they can work together and they work on innovative projects. So that we have big companies, you see a big company of food or agriculture. We have an excellent center of research, and we have a higher education school. And it's about, it's more than 180 members, and we have 70% of SMEs, because the aim of the cluster at the beginning was to give access of the research results for the SMEs that had not so much developed R&D team within their companies. So I will let this. So in terms of achievement, you see that from the beginning of the cluster, when the cluster have been created in 2005, we have a great progression of companies and members joining the cluster. You have seen that we have 70% of small and medium companies. We have big companies, but we have also research and center and high education center schools. And we are present in Burgundy, Franche-Comté, and Île-de-France, Paris. But we have also international companies from all over the world. And what we want in our network is to have members that are really active. So what we look at as an indicator is the rate of companies involved in project. Because you can be a member of a network and do nothing, or just take the information that the network is producing. But what we want is to create, remember our mission is to foster the growth of the member companies, and you can't foster the growth of the member companies if they are not active in this project of R&D. And just to give you the one last pitch about the cluster, we look as results, so we are looking at the turnover that we generate through the innovation projects that we manage within the cluster. We look also at the scientific value of this project and the production of scientific papers or patents. And we also look, the third part is what is at the end on the market and make the growth for the companies. So what are the products and what they deliver on the market. We are really... we think that we think that growth of the company will not be possible if they don't look at international. So we help the company and the smallest one to be aware of the potential of development internationally. How do we do that? We organize a congress every year, so it's an international congress, and it's a way to meet scientists and industry and try to design new partnership, for example. We also have looked at the opportunity of making a partnership with other clusters around the world, and we are focused on some regions, so Japan, South Korea, Russia, Canada, US and Europe, and we organize regularly a mission for our members so that they are able to meet scientists, to meet people, and to make a partnership with them. And we also work in association with the cluster under the WOFIN, World Food Innovation Cluster, gathering 8 clusters that works on the same thematics than us. So, now that you have understood the picture that I tried to give you about the cluster, I will give you some really a practical case of how we mobilize European funds in our activities. The first one is the European Fund for the Regional Development. I just show you one project, it's Clovis. It's an R&D project, and you will understand how we work. So, if you look at the partner, we gather, we cross-fertilized, and we gather members of, company members, so Pépinière Guillaume Cédiag, and we also gather research center. So together, they will address some R&D goals because they have specific expertise. And they will have R&D goals to target new markets, or to target the current market, but with added value. So that is, in this case, it's about finding more robust grape wine. I chose this because I am from Burgundy, so wine is not far from me. Grape-feed seeding and phytodiagnostic kits. That could be the opportunity at the end of the project for the companies to develop that their market. So we work like this. So we only do collaborative projects and with linking to together people from different expertise, academics and industry. So for another project, a little bit different, it's about satiety and wellness with yogurt. And then you have some big company, clinical study company also, and then some academic team from INRA, for example. And then you target some new market or some new segments in yogurt, because you want to give satiety and wellness through your yogurt. You will have to develop new ingredients and flavors. So that means that you will develop also the activities and the economy of this kind of suppliers. And also because in this partnership, you have a company doing appliance, small appliance. You will develop also kitchen device. So I don't go more in detail, but the FEDER, so European Funding for Regional Development, is a direct help for investment, mainly in SMEs, but not only, and also for infrastructure, for research and development, so that can also fund some research team. And for the France, we had, I think I have this data. It's 10 billion euro for the period of 2007-2013. And that means that this fund represents more than 40% of the European budget invested in France by Europe. Alors, if I come back to the first project, Clovis project, in terms of R&D spend, it's the size is 3.5 million euro. And the consortium of academic and company ask for 1.6 million of funding. So it's synergy of different fundings, but I will just speak about the FEDER funding. There is one in the consortium. There is one SME from Franche-Comté region. So the team in Vitagora, in charge of the financial engineering of the project, they have to go to the Franche-Comté regional direction of the Ministry of Forest, Agriculture and Food Industry to ask for this specific fund. And the SME get nearly 50% of the total funding that they ask by this fund. And the fund, the FEDER fund represent 30% of the total project funding. On the other project, because I choose two projects, the funding for regional development was able to fund the totality of the request of the laboratory, so the research laboratory, and 64% of the request in terms of funding of the 100% of the funding of the company is from FEDER, and 35 for the lab. So that is a really great possibility to have a part of the funding, and it's coming from Europe. So that was my first case. The second case is using a country initiative to help the cluster boost French participation in European project, because France found that we have to improve the access of the SMEs to European funding. We don't have so much SMEs going in European project like Horizon 2020 or FP7. And so the French government developed a call, and Vitagora answers this call, and we get the fund by the direction, general direction of the competitiveness and industry and services. And with this funding, So it was a French funding, but I will come back a little bit later about the European funding. So we, what we do with this French funding as a cluster, we include specific action such as information session and a newsletter on European project. Information session, I see Raphael, we invite him as a European national point of contact to explain this European call to our companies. We have done a diagnostic of targeted SMEs that could go on a European project and what were their strategy and what could we address as a research of partners when we receive them. And we help them when they were in a European project. So we get 130 kilo-euros from the DG from France in terms of subvention. And we accompany 350 companies on this information about European calls. And 66 will have been a diagnostic. 13 will was involved in a European project proposal. And 5 companies was in a funded European project. And the total of European funds that they get from this project was 765 kilo euro. So it's an indirect way of mobilizing European fund, but that was my second case. The third one is Europe Enterprise Network, and we develop a strong partnership with them. Because it helps us to develop the economic growth of our members with their specific action. So they were our partners for the previous project I explained you, how they were working with us. They help us to organize information session. They have a common watch on European projects, and they share the SMEs partner thought. They are also partner of the International Congress I told you about in the previous slide, and they help us to organize the business meeting. So it was more than 300 business meeting each year, with 30% of international people involved. And they are also partner for international action program, like for example, we had a mission in Russia in September. So they help us also that. And the last one, but I will not go deeply on that, it's about the smart specialization in the region. So you have seen that we are in 3 regions. In 2 regions, we were really part of this building of the strategy of the region. And why? Because we have done the work for Vitagora for the strategy. We have done already the sound analysis of the regional assets in terms of technology and bioeconomy, because it was the way for us to define our strategy. So we share this with the different region. And because through Vitagora network, we come at the table with a strong partnership with academics, with public entities, and with companies, with our network. So we foster the bioeconomy research in Vitagora homes regions. So that is my last slide. So for me, what are the key lesson points? I think that in our kind of organization, we are only 10. We need to have a dedicated specific resource to work on European opportunities, to foresee the opportunities for our members, because they will not be able alone, an SME, even a medium company will not have the time to understand all the opportunities that Europe has to offer to them. We need to have right partners and work closely with them. We need to build a European network, and we need to be prepared for every opportunity of European funding related to your strategy. And for example, the last example that I can tell you is that I involve in the KIK food best because I, for the moment I need to understand what can help for the growth of our companies to be in this KIK. So I work in the French organization for that. Okay, thank you very much.
Well, we have time for a couple of questions. I have one. How many people do you have in your staff?
10 people.
10 people.
10 people.
Impressive. Yeah.
So leading some networks, and what are your plans if you're looking for the next 5 or 10 years? What is your intention?
I am here in place of my director. That would be a question for him. It's quite difficult. Huh? I think we try to the strategy board is really because we are a small organization. We are very flexible, and we are able to take a turn when even we see that there is an opportunity for our members. So I can't tell you that we have a plan for 10 years. I think it's not true. But we have a plan for the cluster are working 4 years by 4 years. So we will be we have a feuille de route. How we say that? We have a perspective for a strategy for 4 years, and we review that every year.
In France, the clusters are pour de compétitivité, what you said. They will continue if you do good job. It's not foreseen to stop them. Mm. And you're in a region which is very important in terms of food production and quality of food, and also on the research, the nutrition and the university is very, very strong. So I think you can see the future very, very optimistically.
Of course.
And there will be funding for national funding for research and for mixture between research and the economics in the region. So the future can be optimistic for this pour de compétitivité. And at the same time, if you manage to get into the food best project or the food for, I don't know, remember the name exactly.
The cake food.
The cake food. Mm. It will be a very good thing because a lot of people, they are reluctant to go inside this because they say it's a very complex machinery.
Yeah, it's complex, and it's not evident for us to understand where we can play in this organization. So I work with other pôles de compétitivité to the ones that are already included in other KIK, so that we understand and we can build on their experience for the next one.
That's very important. Another question, comment. Well, I have to thank the two speakers. I think it was very informative, having the view from the top and the view from the bottom. Now, all what you have to do is to take their example and try to reach the same success as they did. Good night.